The next item of business is a debate on motion 13368 in the name of Martin Whitfield on Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee's first report 2024, session 6. Can I remind members that the question on these motions will be put immediately after the debate, and I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons. And I call on Martin Whitfield to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the committee. Up to 5 minutes, please.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. And as convener of the Standards, Procedure and Public Appointments Committee, I have the responsibility of lodging and speaking to motions seeking the Parliament's agreement to the committee's recommendation of a sanction in instances where a breach of the conduct rules has occurred. I do that today following the committee's consideration of a report referred to it by the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, SPCB. The report was referred to the committee after the SPCB concluded that there had been breaches of the Code on Conduct by Member Michael Matheson, MSP, in relation to the use of mobile data via a SIM card and a device issued to him by the Parliament. The SPCB had considered three excluded complaints. An excluded complaint is one that doesn't fall within the remit of the Ethical Standards Commissioner. And they determined that breaches had occurred in respect of sections 7.3 and 7.4 of the Code of Conduct. The committee considered the report at five meetings during March and May. The committee was tasked with considering the question of whether or not to recommend to the Parliament any sanctions. It was not tasked with reviewing the SPCB's investigation or decisions, as it does in other cases. As members will be aware, the SPCB reached its decisions on the 14th of March 2024 and referred its report to the committee on the 19th of March 2024. The committee has sought to conclude its consideration as swiftly as possible while ensuring that Michael Matheson was given the opportunity to make representations to us and that those representations and the SPCB report be fully considered. This is the first instance in the Parliament's 25 years of a referral being made by the SPCB to an SPPA committee. The committee has set out in its report that it intends to reflect generally on the process for excluded complaints and has invited reflections from the SPCB. These reflections do not evidence any concern that we have that the process followed up to this point was not adequate or correct. The committee sought to avoid any form of running commentary on the matter under consideration, and I would note the disappointment of the whole committee that at the final stages of our consideration, speculation appeared in the media before we had reached decisions and concluded our considerations. Since March, the committee has carefully considered all of the information available to it in the SPCB's report, in both written and in personal representations made by Mr. Matheson. And this has enabled the committee to take into account a fuller picture of the role of an outdated SIM SIM card and charges that were incurred, the circumstances of the usage, the allocation of £3,000 from Mr. Matheson's office cost provision, the knowledge that Mr. Matheson had at the point of allocation, and actions taken by Mr. Matheson between the point at which he stated he became aware that non-parliamentary usage had occurred and his personal statement that he made to this chamber. During our consideration, we noted areas where we believe that more action should have been taken on the part of the Parliament in relation to the replacement of an outdated SIM card. The committee also acknowledges the impact of the significant media and other intrusions which took place on Mr. Matheson and his family. Following its consideration, the committee was unanimous in its view that sanctions should be recommended and that there should be a period of exclusion and a financial element to the recommended sanctions. The committee was also unanimous in its view as to the financial element of the sanctions. It is, however, important to acknowledge, as set out in the committee's report, that two members of the committee Alistair Allen and Jackie Dunbar noted that they agreed with the financial element but considered it was at the higher range of available sanctions. The one area on which there was not unanimous agreement was the duration of the period of exclusion. After discussion, the committee was not in a position to give a unanimous recommendation on a suspension period from Parliament. A majority of members of the committee agreed that a duration of 27 days was appropriate. As set out in the committee's report, some members of the committee, Oliver Mundell, supported by Annie Wells, had originally supported a longer period of exclusion, while others, Alistair Allen and Jackie Dunbar, supported a shorter period, as, in their view, this was extremely severe when compared to previous cases. The issues under consideration by the committee have ultimately been about the use of public finance, the degree of trust that there must be both in and outside of the Parliament, that those funds are used only for legitimate purposes, and that the ethical standards with which members must conduct themselves in all matters as articulated in the Nolan Principles and the Code of Conduct. Any failure to meet these standards has an adverse impact on the reputation of the expenses scene, members and this Parliament as a whole. And therefore, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Kate Forbes to speak to and move Amendment 133.68.1 up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Firstly, let me start by saying that Michael Matheson was found to have breached the standards expected of him by a cross-party group of MSPs, including the SNP. The First Minister has not criticised the findings of the Scottish Parliament corporate body. Secondly, breaches like this should be proportionately sanctioned. Michael Matheson has paid back the roaming costs and there's been no cost to the public purse. His actions have had consequences. He lost his cabinet position despite being one of the longest serving ministers of this Parliament. He's faced considerable reputational damage and significant intrusion in his personal life. Yes, I will.
Christine Graham.
Thank you very much. I find this very difficult. Because the Scottish Government Amendment, Deputy First Minister, specifically references a referral to the Scottish Parliament's corporate body, as an elected member of that body, identifying as I do a real or perceived conflict of interest, I will recuse myself and will abstain on the amendment, and if the motion is amended, I will abstain on that too.
Deputy First Minister.
I thank the member for those comments which are on the record, and hopefully, Presiding Officer, you'll look favourably on a slight extension to my comments. Having established in my opening remarks that a breach occurred and that actions have consequences, I come to my third point, which relates to how the Standards Committee have determined the sanctions. And this is where we have grave concerns captured in the amendment. Parliament must engage with these concerns with only 4 minutes. I'd really value just getting to the end, if that's OK. Parliament must engage with these concerns because to dismiss them now will have serious consequences for members who in the future may themselves be the subject of the committee's investigation. There's a fundamental principle of natural justice at stake here. And I want to say pointedly that it is the principle that I will base my remarks on and not the personalities. Because whilst I believe that Annie Wells should have resigned from the Standards Committee, like Stephen Kerr, I do not want to see any abuse or harassment of MSPs, of Annie Wells or of Michael Matheson. Because the principle of fair, impartial and proportionate justice is captured in the comments made by Conservative member Stephen Kerr. And if I could get to the end of these comments, I could come. Stephen Kerr, a member of the committee, and I said, and I quote at length, "I concluded that I couldn't meet the committee requirement to be unbiased toward Michael Matheson and his conduct in public office." And he said it would have been wrong to sit on the committee having made so many public pronouncements, and that for due process to be observed, I feel I must resign from the committee. The member wants to come in. I would ask, was he right then and is he right now?
Stephen Kerr.
I'm grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way. But this amendment is nothing but an attack on the integrity of a member of this Parliament. Does she, of all people, having been through what she has been through in the last year, not recognise Kate Forbes, what Kate Forbes has been through over the last year? Does she not recognise that this is an attack on an honourable member and is motivated by vindictive purposes?
Deputy First Minister.
I have been very clear that my remarks relate to the principle, not the personality, and I would invite Stephen Kerr to reflect precisely on that point in his remarks. The point here is that in light of Stephen Kerr's comments, when other members of the Standards Committee also made public comments, they should have recused themselves. Another member declared in public that Mr. Matheson's position was untenable, he should quit, he should be sacked as minister, and that his admission should not be believed. By any measure, that clearly prejudges the complaint and the sanction. Presiding officer, as such, we invite the SPCB to initiate an independent review of the Parliament's complaints process to restore integrity and confidence in the procedures so that all MSPs have confidence in the Parliament's processes and procedures. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Douglas Ross, up to 4 minutes, please.
Presiding officer, we are debating a report from the Standards Committee of this Parliament. Its representation is made up of the three largest parties in this chamber, and they have agreed a suspension which will seem lenient to the public, but does represent the most severe action ever taken against a member of this Parliament. Michael Matheson will be suspended for 27 days and his pay will be docked for 54 days. But we must be honest. Any other Scot would have been handed their P45 straight away. If someone is found to have falsely claimed £11,000 from their employer, in this case the taxpayer, then they lied about it as part of a cover-up, they would have been sacked. Let me be clear, this is not a harmless mistake that some have attempted to present it as. This was a deliberate and shameless attempt to pull the wool over the eyes of this Parliament and the public. It is an open and shut case, a case that has already been considered in great detail by the Scottish Parliament corporate body and by the Standards Committee. And this independent process exists for a reason, and it should be respected and upheld by members across the chamber. Yet instead, what we have seen from SNP members, and specifically from John Swinney, the First Minister, is an attempt to derail and undermine due process. And this has been done for the sole purpose of protecting one of their own. Now, I want to put on record that the actions of John Swinney, the actions of the First Minister towards my colleague Annie Wells would make Donald Trump blush. It is disgusting and disgraceful behaviour that demeans the office of First Minister, because he has targeted members of an independent committee in this Parliament and is attempting to undermine due process with his bully boy tactics. Now, Presiding Officer, I've looked at who has been in agreement with John Swinney during the process, not now, and we've heard from the Deputy First Minister that she agrees with John Swinney. But I can find nothing on record to suggest that at any point, while this has been considered by the Standards Committee, that Jackie Dunbar, an SNP member, raised any concerns, Alistair Allen, an SNP member, raised any concerns about Annie Wells being included, or Ivan McKee raised any concerns about Annie Wells being included. I'll come back in a minute. I then looked at Michael Matheson's own personal statement. Now, he was asked to provide a personal statement to the committee. It runs to 10 pages. It is 5,500 words. At no point is there any reference to his concerns that Annie Wells was sitting on a committee to judge his fate. No, I'm just going to make this point. The only person, well, if I get time, I will. If I get time, I will. The only person, the one MSP who raised complaints during the process was John Swinney. He was the only one to do it. And then I was hoping to intervene on the Deputy First Minister, but I will let her intervene on me because I am puzzled with the approach we now have from the SNP. Are we really going to have the bizarre and perhaps unique approach of in the Scottish Parliament, a bizarre and unique approach in the Scottish Parliament, where the SNP successfully amend a motion to the wording of their choice, and then the SNP won't vote for the SNP amended motion? Will the Deputy First Minister confirm that is her plan this afternoon?
Do continue, Mr Ross.
Well, I'm unsure. So are we in uncharted territory? Are we in uncharted territory where the SNP... Do I get extra time for interventions, Presiding Officer? Yeah. Maybe Alistair Allen can tell us, has he been whipped to vote for the SNP amendment? And if that SNP amendment is successful, well, then he vote it down.
Alistair Allen.
The member may have forgotten, but when I attempted to get in on him some minutes ago, he was making the claim that I had never raised the issue of a member of the committee having tweeted about matters in advance. I wasn't going to say this, but I did actually privately raise this with the convener of the committee. And it's supposed to be in private, not that everything from this committee was.
Douglas Ross, in conclusion...
So therefore, I was correct. No public statements from any MSP apart from John Swinney. And no answer. No answer. So SNP MSPs, if they listen, just so we get this correct, SNP MSPs are going to vote to amend the motion to the wording of their choice and are then not going to support the SNP's motion today. It is bizarre in the extreme. Presiding Officer, this has been a sorry saga for this SNP government from the beginning. But John Swinney had the opportunity to clean the slate. Instead, he chose to support his friend and colleague in direct opposition to the Scottish public. Unlike the SNP, the Scottish Conservatives will back this ban today. Michael Matheson has failed the public and he has failed this Parliament. His actions are indefensible. But amazingly, John Swinney and the SNP continue to oppose any punishment of their friend and colleague. In closing, people across Scotland
are watching in disbelief,
and they are watching the SNP.
Thank you. I now call on Jackie Bailey.
Presiding Officer, can I start by thanking the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee for their report on the complaint about Michael Matheson MSP. It is difficult to sit in judgment of your colleagues, but given the severity of the situation, the committee have arrived at a judgment that Mr Matheson should be excluded for 27 sitting days with the further sanction of losing his salary for 54 calendar days. And I believe that their recommendations reflect the seriousness of the members' actions. What is not disputed is that sanctions should be applied. The Standards Committee were unanimous on this point. Michael Matheson used a parliamentary iPad inappropriately. He allowed his family to use the device as a hotspot to watch football games whilst on holiday in Morocco. Now, for those of us with experience of teenage children, we understand and have sympathy with the challenges. Had Michael Matheson confessed when first challenged, it might have led to one day's uncomfortable headlines and an acknowledgement from all of us that there but for the grace of God we go. But the problem was that there was no admission of error, no apology, no contrition. Instead, there appears to have been denial, deflection and dishonesty. Emails from Parliament staff to remind members about changing broadband providers, ignored for years. Emails to tell the Parliament if a member was going abroad so that they could adjust the broadband package, also ignored. And most problematic of all, questions from Parliament staff about the scale of the iPad bill, largely ignored and ultimately denied. Even the most diligent MSP cannot run up an £11,000 roaming charges bill, especially at Christmas when constituents have other priorities. But this pattern of denial continued, misleading Parliament, misleading the press, and ultimately misleading the people of Scotland. It is, Presiding Officer, the cover-up rather than the original sin that is always the problem. And it is the contempt of his actions for the Parliament, for the press and the public that I am most disappointed by. This is a profound error of judgment from someone who I have always had a great deal of respect for, despite being in different political parties. He was one of the class of 99. We entered Parliament together, and he should have known better. And whilst I would clash with him regularly about health policy, I recognised his commitment to the NHS. But that has all been swept away by his actions. I am disappointed with the SNP's amendment, but not surprised. They clearly cannot politically amend the scale of the sanction, as they know they cannot win the vote. Instead, this is an attack on the committee and, by extension, this very Parliament itself. This is about John Swinney protecting his friend. This is John Swinney undermining the integrity of the Parliament, something he already has form for doing. And this is about John Swinney putting party before country. Ultimately, it should be for the people of Falkirk West to decide whether they want Michael Matheson to continue to represent them. But their voice is denied because this Parliament has no provision for a recall petition, something that I will discuss in the debate that follows, because that is surely an omission we should rectify. The public are right to expect the very highest standards from their MSPs. But Michael Matheson's actions have brought our politics into disrepute, and John Swinney's attitude in wanting to protect an SNP MSP adds fuel to the fire. It is truly party before country every time with the SNP. So I hope that members will vote in support of the Standards Committee to restore integrity to our politics.
Thank you. I now call on Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Presiding Officer, and I hope to be brief in my comments. The Scottish Greens will support the sanction recommended by the committee, and Mr Matheson should be held accountable for his actions. Beyond that, Presiding Officer, I want to lay out our concerns about the committee process in this case and in more general terms. I do believe that members who commented publicly on the guilt of the member being investigated should have recused themselves from the process. I believe this should equally apply to anyone in the future who expressed their thoughts on the innocence or guilt of a colleague. There should also have been public condemnation before today of the leak of the potential sanctions the day before the committee met. More generally, the process needs reform. We don't, for example, take precedent into account. And I know that the convener of the SPPA committee and I disagree on this, and I'm aware that there are differing opinions. But we are currently in a situation where previously an MSP had been sanctioned for sexual harassment, received a lesser sanction than the one in front of us today. I certainly hope that members in this chamber would agree that harm to people should carry the greatest sanctions. Taking previous sanctions into account would allow us to ensure that sanctions are consistent. We also allocate these committees in the same way we do for scrutiny committees. If we want this to be truly cross-party and considered fair, the allocation of seats on the committee and the makeup of that committee needs looked at to ensure fairness and to prevent politicisation of sanctions. The process at Westminster, while far from perfect, is better than the one we have here and provides some things we may be able to adopt. I hope, Presiding Officer, that in the coming weeks, Parliament will be able to take a serious look at the process and have a serious conversation on how we fix and depoliticise this process.
Thank you. I now call on Willie Rennie.
We will vote in favour of the recommendation by the Standards Committee. However we may dislike the outcomes, we will find ourselves in a very difficult territory if we take a pick-and-mix approach to the recommendations of the Parliament's established processes. With regards to the concerns of the First Minister, although Annie Wells could have followed the course of action taken by Stephen Kerr, she was not required to do so by parliamentary standing orders. On Kate Forbes' amendment, I'm troubled, I have to say, by the government seeking to issue instructions with regard to the complaint process and its independence, especially in a case where there was so much agreement. The Scottish Parliament corporate body and the Scottish Parliament Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee both agreed that Section 7.3 and 7.4 of the Members' Code of Conduct had been breached by Mr Matheson. That conclusion was reached by all members, including those from the SNP. All members, including the SNP members, agreed Mr Matheson had made an improper claim. All members, including the SNP, agreed Mr Matheson failed to undertake a sufficient level of inquiry before submitting the claim. All members, including the SNP, agreed Mr Matheson failed to abide by the policies adopted by the corporate body. All members, including the SNP, agreed Mr Matheson failed to ensure that his parliamentary iPad hotspot facility was not used for non-parliamentary purposes to a significant extent. All members, including the SNP, agreed Mr Matheson failed to inform the corporate body during the important period, not just now, during the important period between the 9th and the 16th of November that his previous statement was unsound. That was very grave. All members of the Standards Committee agreed on the financial penalty. All members of the committee agreed that there should be a suspension. The only disagreement was in the number of days that Mr Matheson should be suspended. Oliver Mundell initially proposed 54-day suspension to match the financial penalty. He made a second compromise proposal to halving it to 27 days. No alternative was proposed by SNP members, and subsequently the 27 days was agreed by the committee. 9 times there was agreement. Only once was there disagreement. Only once. It is therefore wrong to undermine the whole process, especially when there was so much unanimity through the whole process. But there is a warning, and this is important, there is a warning to those who voted for, not just now, who voted for a tougher sanction in the committee. A new bar, a new standard has been set. And I take the points that Gillian Mackay has made about precedent, but from my perspective, it will now be expected that the level of penalty agreed by the committee in this case will be applied in future cases of a similar nature and severity. It cannot be one rule for SNP members who err, and another rule for Conservative MSPs, Green MSPs, Labour MSPs, or even, dare I say, Liberal Democrat MSPs who breach the rules. Of course, not every complaint is exactly the same, but members of the committee will have to act fairly and consistently when applying these penalties in future. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Kate Forbes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As I outlined earlier, our fundamental disagreement is not on the principle that a breach occurred or that actions have consequences. I think Willie Rennie set out quite comprehensively where the areas of agreement are. These principles have been established, and we agree. Instead, our amendment is about a third principle, the principle of fair, impartial and proportionate justice when it comes to sanctions. All MSPs now and in the future need to rely on, to trust and to have confidence in the Parliament's processes and procedures. I won't give way, thank you. They need to know that we have a system in place where Parliament and procedure matters more than politics. And that should apply equally to members of every party, because every party has had members who have been subject to this process over the years. And all parties have demonstrated their ability to be impartial when it comes to the application of justice on fellow members. I think that the member has obviously shared his views already, and I think I would quite like to complete this. Perhaps one of the highest profile examples of this was at Westminster. Chris Bryant, Labour MP, recused himself from presiding over the investigation into Boris Johnson. Referencing public comments he had previously made about the then Prime Minister, he recused himself from the committee potentially tasked with conducting the investigation. He explained at the time, and I quote, "It is important that the House be seen to proceed fairly without any imputation of unfairness, and that the whole House has confidence in the Committee of Privileges proceedings. That was despite also saying that he believed that he would have done everything in his power to ensure that the inquiry was fair, consensual and evidence-based. Because you see, Presiding Officer, the perception of unfairness is just as damaging to justice as the fact of unfairness. And I believe that there is an opportunity for parties to work across the chamber to inspire confidence in our procedures. And surely, as we mark a quarter of a century into the Scottish Parliament, now is the time to do so. And in that vein, I note Jackie Bailey's comments and the Labour amendment in the next debate about recall of MSPs. If agreement can be reached, there's no reason why a form of recall cannot be introduced to this Parliament with cross-party support. That must be preceded by an independent process built on the well-established tenets of evidence-based, impartial and proportionate justice. But the recall process at Westminster is based on an entirely independent complaints procedure which has inbuilt rights of appeal. And I believe that it's time for this Parliament, through the Scottish Parliament corporate body, to initiate an independent review of the complaints process. And perhaps on that we agree. The objective must be to ensure that members of the Scottish Parliament abide by the highest standards of integrity in public service, that they give confidence to the public that actions do have consequences, and that there is a process to determine that, a process which is free of bias, free of prejudice and free of politics. And, Presiding Officer, as I close, I do think that out of this situation we can work collectively to avoid bringing any of our procedures into disrepute and ensure they are fit for the future. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Martin Whitfield to wind up the debate on behalf of the committee.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer, and I have, as expected, different views being expressed today. But I would like just to clarify some of the points that have been raised. And I'm going to first turn to Willie Rennie and his contribution. And I would urge members in this House, in this chamber, and I would urge people outside of the Scottish Parliament to read the report in full. It is not the role of the committee to review the investigation or the decisions that were reached. We were tasked with a question about whether there should be or indeed the extent of any sanction. With regard to comments that were made about the committee's references, a lot of what we undertook privately. The Deputy First Minister has talked about the need for fair, impartial and proportionate justice. Let me phrase, I hope with her consent, that into the world of natural justice. And one of the things that the committee undertook before we started any procedures, any evidence, was to discuss and agree the procedure that we as a whole committee took. Alistair Allen did not serve on the committee at that stage because of changes that have occurred within the Scottish Government, but the committee were unanimous in the view that they were going to take on how it was going to be taken forward, and that would have been the opportunity, if there were concerns among committee members themselves, to express those views. I'm happy to...
Jackie Dunbar.
The member for taking an intervention. There has been mention today in chamber that I raised no concerns regarding the remarks made about another committee member. Will the convener, the member, correct the record today? And also, will he inform the chamber when the letters from John Swinney were actually shared with the committee? Because I think those points are very important.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Jackie Dunbar for that intervention and indeed for her role on the committee. And there are a number of things that she raises with regard to it. The correspondence from, with greatest respect, First Minister, the correspondence from Mr. Swinney arrived after we had agreed the process that we were going to take forward and the makeup of the committee. And the provisions for how a committee is made up is set in our standing orders. I understand that, well, I know that they have now been published for people to see. With also, with regard to, and again I turn with respect to Willie Rennie, with regard to the process that we reached the decision that's expressed in the report, there was long and respectful discussion about periods of time that would or would not be put. And again, I would draw members to our report and indeed to those outside to please read the report, which will give an explanation of where we got to. There has also been a question about a leak. Any leaks sit within the purview of the Independent Ethical Standards Commissioner, and if anyone has any information regarding to that, that is the appropriate vehicle to take. It is important that we reflect that we are dealing with matters of genuine and significant concern. I am going to decline simply because of the passage of time. It is important to reflect that we are dealing with matters of genuine and significant concern regarding the way members conduct themselves in their parliamentary duties and the ethical standards framework that we must uphold. These are known as the Nolan Principles. It is an honour to be elected to this place, but one of the consequences of that honour is the absolute obligation we have to set higher standards for ourselves than we expect of those who have not been elected, but also to uphold those standards. The committee is an important manifestation of that expectation. That is how respect is developed, and that is how respect is maintained. So that when and if we have to ask our communities some of the hardest questions or ask of them some of the hardest actions, we can do so without being selfish, with integrity, with objectivity, with accountability, with openness, honesty and leadership. I'm grateful, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, we are dealing with a situation this afternoon which I think is an extremely important one. There were questions posed this afternoon to the convener, which were not answered by the convener. He's just talked about honour and respect. And I think it is absolutely essential that members have the answers to the questions that were posed by Dr. Allen and Ms. Dunbar around about what they have said to the convener privately. The convener has not answered those questions. I think this is extremely pertinent
members,
to the matter that we are discussing today. And in order that we make the right decision here today, convener, I would like to hear the convener, with honour and respect, answering those questions.
I am sure Mr. Stewart is well aware of the fact that that is not a point of order, and that it is entirely up to members themselves as to their response to questions put or any contribution in this chamber. That concludes the debate on Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee's First Report 2024, Session 6, and there are two questions to be put. The first question is that Amendment 13368.1, in the name of Kate Forbes, which seeks to amend Motion 13368 in the name of Martin Whitfield, on Standards, Procedures and Public Appointment Committee's First Report 2024, Session 6, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.